pray tonight for living revelation in your word, of your ways. We thank you, God, that you are a God who is past searching out. Lord, in some ways you are unknowable because of how awesome you are, but yet you have called us to know you and to seek you and to search for you, because there are secrets and things in your heart that you want to reveal even in this generation. And Father, we thank you tonight for those things. And we come hungry. We come thirsty tonight, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Ask for you, Lord, to help us see and hear those things that you want to reveal. In Yeshua's name, everyone said amen.
Amen.
We're continuing our study tonight on the everlasting covenant.
Hallelujah.
Aren't you glad God doesn't decide to just cancel the contract when things get hard?
Oh, that's good.
But his arms are short. Hallelujah. Turn your scriptures tonight to Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55. You know, a Sabbath service last week, a few days ago, there was just that awesome prophetic movement, and the word of the Lord came out in the service. And I don't know if you remember, I want to go back and just listen, because there were so many things that came out. Don actually said he's going to try to capture some of those and put them up on YouTube for us a little bit. So that'll be good to go back and hear some of the words that came out and steward that a little better. But there was such a flow of mercy.
When you get the notes, tell us what page you're on.
Okay, there'll be a while before I get there. It was such a flow of mercy in the Sabbath service. And as I was just meditating on a scripture to start with tonight, I just came across Isaiah 55. And I just want to read that as we start tonight. And Mark's been having us pray, as the scripture here is Matthew 4:6, to come before the throne of grace and to receive mercy and favor for the day that we live in. But look at this again in Isaiah 55, verse 1. It says, "Oh, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters." I felt led to put on a waiting soaking CD tonight. Miss Cheryl had played it at Shabbat, that just had that water, you know, just that water sound, the voice of God. "And you who have no silver, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without silver and without price." Verse 2, "Why do you weigh out silver for what is not bread, and your labor for what does not satisfy?" You know, sometimes we work hard for things that just aren't going to be around forever and aren't going to satisfy. And sometimes we work hard for that silver, but that silver isn't what we should be laboring for. We labor to enter into what? The kingdom. And as we do, then God, our Father, takes care of our needs. Does that mean we don't labor? No, we do have to do natural work. But where do we put most of our effort? Where did we put most of our effort today? You know, just think about including the Father. If we'll include the Father in our plans, He'll include you in His.
Right, yes.
Look at how we can do that. In the middle of the chapter, verse 2, it says, "Listen." And unfortunately, God has to tell us that usually a couple times. "Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and let your being delight itself in fatness." You know, we can work for silver all day, and we can work for things that don't satisfy. But if we will just incorporate a time in our day when we will listen, when we will listen for that stream of living water that constantly comes from the throne of our Father, He will share secrets with us. He will share what is good with us. And He will bring delight in us. And we will have fatness in the Spirit. Amen?
Yeah.
Richness in the Spirit. A bountiful table. Number 3, incline your ear. Again, notice what He's talking about. He's talking about listening here. Because what is our bread? Verse 2, it says, "Why do you work for silver that's not bread?" What is our bread? Yeshua said in the temptation, He said, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by the very words that come forth from the Father." Yes. His words are bread. They sustain our spirit.
That's right.
We have His words. And so we will get fat on that. We will have the goodness of that. And if we incline our ear, it says, "Incline your ear and come to me and hear." Notice what He's talking about. It's not a volatile explosion of words gushing forth out of us. That's the exhortation here, to come and receive. If we're thirsty, if we have a need, if we recognize our need for living water, we need to come and listen. Listen. Yeah. We need to come and incline our ear to Him. And come to me. And again, notice He says, hear, so that your being lives. And let me make an everlasting covenant with you. I was just so impacted today, earlier when I was meditating on this scripture, that God is saying, let me. I mean, this is sovereign God who can do anything.
Yeah.
But He is saying, listen, listen. Incline your ear. He is saying, hear. And then He is saying, let me. If we will listen, if we will hear, then He wants to do what with us? With us. He wants to establish an everlasting covenant. And that's what we've been looking into with you. Say with me.
With me.
In trustworthy, loving commitment of David. Now, what struck me is in the King James, it says, in trustworthy mercies, the everlasting mercies of David. And God was emphasizing mercy, to cry out for mercy for our nation on Sabbath. And I just want to encourage you, and even over your own life right now, cry out for mercy. For mercy to pray.
Yes.
For mercy to seek the Father's voice. Yes. For mercy for our nation. Mercy over the election. We need mercy over this election. Oh my, I heard something today, but I'm not going there. We need mercy. We need mercy, and we need to cry out for mercy that is everlasting commitment to us. And then go over to verse 6. It says, seek Jehovah while He is to be found. He is not always to be found. You know, when the flood started and the door to the ark was shut, you couldn't find God's mercy at that moment.
That's right.
But God's mercy can still be found. If we will seek Him, now we can find it. Call on Him while He is near. Let the wrong forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to Jehovah, who has compassion on him, and to our Elohim, for He pardons much. Hallelujah.
Mercy.
And then He says, the verse that we ponder on a lot, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. And then the comparison He gives, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. That's why we need to come to Him and listen. That's why we need to come to Him and incline our ear, because He knows more than we do. Amen?
That's right.
I always like to use this analogy when I'm ministering to one of those smart people. You ever witness to a smart person? A person who's so smart they don't need God, or so rich they don't need God? One of the things I like to do, and I don't have a board up here, but there's a little spot. Say there's a spot on this wall right here. And say that's one I know. If you came to me tonight and asked me to do brain surgery or heart surgery or maybe, you know, lay fiber optic around the city and connect it or, you know, do something, I just don't know that. I might know this right here. And anybody you talk to thinks they just know so much they don't know God, they might know that. But say that wall, which is a terrible analogy because God's wisdom has no end, but that wall represents the knowledge of God. Is it just possible that what we think and know about God isn't all there is?
That's right.
Come on.
Is it possible there's more? Wow. And there is more. Because His ways are higher than His ways, than our ways. So say it tonight. Father.
Father.
Give me your thoughts.
Give me your thoughts.
Father.
Father.
Show me your ways.
Show me your ways.
I want to come to you and listen.
I want to come to you and listen.
I want to come to you and learn.
I want to come to you and learn.
Hallelujah. I've been trying to save some of the update stuff to the end, and we haven't been getting it, and I felt led to do that, but I do want to hit a couple things tonight, just for a matter of prayer and just knowing that what's going on. In the back of your notes from last week, if you had that, you should have an article by Michael Snyder that was released on March 24, 2016 from his endoftheamericandream.com website. And the name of the article is, Will a Gateway Be Opened When the Arch of the Temple of Baal is Reconstructed in Times Square?
Where is this?
Wow.
It should be on the back of the last week's notes.
Looks
the very
like that.
Last thing. Looks like that. Mark's holding it up there. If not, it's on this set of notes. Do you have 3:30? Oh, there you go. All right. Will a gateway be opened? But in New York and in London, on, I believe it is April 19th, A company called Digital Archaeology is going to be 3D printing, reproducing, and erecting a 48-foot tall arch that stood at the entrance of the Temple of Baal. Now, the company's motive, they say, for doing this is that ISIS recently destroyed this relic in Syria. So in trying to overcome that, of all things they could have picked, they picked the Archway of Baal to reconstruct in New York City and in London. And I found another article, which I couldn't dig up before service, that it's also in a thousand other cities they're going to be putting these up. Wow. Now, that's interesting, and you can read that article that's in your note in and of itself. But later, since last week, I came across this article from prophecynewswatch.com, and you don't have this one. If anybody wants one, I make you a copy. But it says, April 19th, Temple of Baal in New York is going up on a significant day. And this is just another piece of the puzzle we need to be aware of. The person who wrote this says, it turns out that the exact day when reproductions of the arch that stood in the front of the Temple of Baal are going to be erected in Times Square, New York, and in London, is also the exact day when a very important occult festival related to the worship of Baal begins. The interesting thing is, on April 19th, which I think is just a couple of weeks, is the first day of a 13-day period of time known as the Blood Sacrifice of the Beast. That's what it's known of in pagan circles. That culminates on the high occult holy day called Beltane on May 1st. In some parts of the world, Beltane, and I may not be pronouncing that correct, is much better known as May Day and has been described as the Illuminati's second most sacred holiday. Now, the interesting thing about this is 4 days before Passover, and what do we celebrate on Passover? I'm not your mama, you can tell that to me. What do we celebrate on Passover?
The lamb.
The Lord passing over the blood of the lamb, right?
You know, they also celebrate Earth Day on Passover.
I noticed that this year. That's interesting.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It fell on that one this year.
He is the creator of Earth.
Come on, hallelujah.
Yeah. But he didn't sing on Earth Day.
It's 2 days before Passover.
It's the 19th. Passover's the 22nd. So, yeah. But it's falling on an occultic high holy day called the Blood Sacrifice. And it's a couple days before our Passover, where we celebrate the blood of the Lamb. The April 19th is also known as the Feast of Molech. If you know anything about Molech, he was the ancient Canaanite god who was repeatedly denounced in the Old Testament and called for child sacrifice to go on with his worship. Is it just a coincidence that reproductions of the arch that stood in front of the Temple of Baal in Palmyra, Syria, are going up in New York and London on the precise day when the Feast of Moloch is celebrated and when the blood sacrifices of the beast begin? Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of people link Baal and Molech with the Antichrist. So that's just interesting things happening in your nation, or some other interesting things happened not too long ago in New York City with a religious figure. But it says, we have indeed witnessed some very noteworthy blood sacrifices during the second half of the month of April over the past few decades. And then they list a few. April 19th, 1993 was the Waco Massacre. April 19th, 1995 was the Oklahoma City bombing.
Wow.
April 20th, 1999 was the Columbine High School Massacre. April 16th, so it's around that time, 2007 Virginia Tech Massacre. April 16th, the Boston Marathon explosions. I don't know about you, but I didn't realize all that was so close together in April with that.
Sounds like blood sacrifices to me.
Sounds like that, doesn't it? And it says, I also wanted to note that since 2016 is a leap year, that April 20th will be the 111th day of the year. And triple numbers are considered to be quote-unquote power dates in the occult world. So it says, so is it just a coincidence that we are erecting arches for this ancient deity in New York and London on a date that is exceedingly significant for those who worship that ancient deity.
Wow.
So I want to ask you specifically to be in prayer about that, and to go before the Father and cry for mercy.
Yes.
And just pray, you know, the company may be being used unknowingly. Their intentions may be good. That happens. But there are forces in the world that would like to take advantage of that. And I haven't done a CERN update in a while. I'm not going to get into that tonight. But one of the guys that I follow scientifically that researches them prophetically also has reported that they have found the particle that they were wanting to find, and all they have to do is link an explosion with that in the quantum world, and they will rip the veil. And they're waiting for the time to do that. Now, that's a short explanation of a very long process this guy went through to get that. But that's something else to be in prayer about. It's interesting. They're putting portals in major cities, and CERN is ready, according to Anthony Patch, one of the guys I follow. So just interesting things going on. And also, as another prophetic update, and I ran some of these off because some of you may want one of these. You know, the blood moons came, the blood moons went. And sometimes people don't get the significance of what happened. And there is another guy on YouTube I like. He is called Discover Ministries, I believe it is. And his web address, I think, is on his logo here. And I totally want to give him credit for this on YouTube. But I just took a screenshot of his program because he had the best analysis of this that I've seen. And what it is, it says Pentrad, five blood moons. But the first blood moon that we just went through, the blood moons, I think we're all on that page, triggered the 50-day war with Israel and Gaza and Syria with ISIS. The second blood moon triggered the public beheadings. The solar eclipse in between them triggered Saudi invasion of Yemen. The third blood moon triggered Iranian nuke deal and gay marriage. The partial solar eclipse again triggered Muslim immigration crisis. And the fourth blood moon triggered Russian in Syria. And I don't know if you guys know about Nathan's vision. If you know about Nathan's vision, would you raise your hand? Okay, Nathan was a young man in Israel, real quick, 13 years old, Orthodox.
Yeah.
So he wasn't raised in Torah school, knew nothing about scripture. He was just a secular Jew living in Israel. And he has a death experience in the hospital, dies, and goes to heaven, and has an encounter, and comes back with a message. Nathan is a 13-year-old boy in Israel, was not raised in Torah, totally secular, did not know the word, dies, has an encounter with God, comes back. The first thing he does, if I remember this correctly, you can watch this on YouTube, but he finds a school, I forgot the name of it, where they teach Torah in Israel. And he goes in and he tells this rabbi what happened to him because he came back with a message. And of what's going to happen in Israel in the next few days concerning years, but it's concerning war, the Messiah, actually mentions President Obama, and some things that the Lord tells him. So he tells another rabbi, and this rabbi gets on YouTube with them, and one of their little schools, all the little men are sitting down, the women are all up in the balcony like they do, and he starts relaying his vision of what he saw, and you can just tell that the young man really doesn't know what he has. And he starts describing things that the prophets talk about that he didn't know was in there. And the rabbi will smile and he'll say, Isaiah said that, you know, and the young man says, really, that's in the Torah, or the, you know, what they call the Old Testament, Tanakh. And so they just go through all that. And it's really amazing, you know, what happens with that. But I forgot what article I was quoting on that. Oh, he was talking about the blood moons. That on the fourth blood moon triggered Russian in Syria and Nathan's vision. So Nathan is the young man. If you go to YouTube and put in Nathan's vision, in fact, the Discovery guy has a whole lesson on it. I have not watched his lesson on it, so I don't know what he says, but he thought it was valid enough to present it, so it was interesting. Nathan did say that in heaven the Lord revealed to him that Obama was Gog and Magog.
Mm-hmm.
So that was just an interesting thought. But let's go back to our notes, and we're just going to have to keep going tonight. But before we start with letter A, turn to Psalm 33. And I want to read this because we're looking about creation and the two creation accounts that are heading out and are going to come to heads more in the future as we see this unfold. But let's just read tonight in Psalms 33, verse 1. This is, shout for joy in Jehovah. Let me hear hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You righteous. Praise. That's us, isn't it? Praise is fitting for the upright, for the straight. Praise Jehovah with the lyre. Sing to him with an instrument of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play sweetly with a shout of joy. For the word of Jehovah is straight, and all his works are in truth. Loving righteousness and right ruling, the earth is filled with the loving commitment of Jehovah. Yes. And you know, that is a good meditation. We're not waiting for the earth to be filled with the loving commitment of Jehovah. The earth is filled with the loving commitment of Jehovah. You know, in Isaiah 61, it says, and gross darkness will cover the earth. And it also says that the glory of God has arisen on us. So it's been interesting as we walk through this journey that you have the gross darkness that we don't need to be ignorant about. But then we also have the glory of God that's rising on us. So, are we okay? So we need both focuses. We need to be aware of the darkness, not ignorant of the devil's schemes and his devices. But we also need to know the glory of God, which there is no comparison, amen, is rising and has risen upon us and will one day be visible upon us. But say it with me tonight. The earth
is filled
with the loving commitment of Jehovah.
With the loving commitment of Jehovah.
Hallelujah. Now notice the segue into creation here. Verse 6, by the word of Jehovah the heavens were made, and all their hosts by the wind or the spirit of his mouth. Come on. Gathering the waters of the sea together as a heap, laying up the deep in storehouses. Now, when you realize God is creator and you realize everything about this, then the appropriate response should be verse 8. Let all the earth fear Jehovah. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood fast. No, there's a lot in this, in a future lesson that we may break down. But God is creator. And if you notice here, we're reading in Psalms. And even in these verses, when you break them down in the Hebrew, there's so many hints of what God is saying and speaking besides just Genesis 1. Genesis 1 is the preeminent start-out creation focus, but creation is not the focus of the book of Genesis. Amen? So salvation and the redemptive plan is. So you have to go through the Psalms, the wisdom literature, the prophets, Genesis, and to get the whole panorama of creation and God as creator and what really was going on there, which we're going to get into a little bit tonight. You need to pull from all these sources. And I'm tempted to go through the rest of this, but I'm not for that. But let's go ahead and go to our study sheets tonight, letter A. It says, in this study, as we are becoming acquainted with the idea that the ancient Sumerian creation account with its ancient evidence around the world is being used to undermine the scriptural creation account and could become the premise of deception used as the lie mentioned in 2 Thessalonians that is given at the revealing of the Antichrist. Now, there have been many Antichrists in times past. Yeah. There is a spirit of Antichrist that is at work even in John's day when he wrote, all right? But there will be the final man of perdition, the embodiment of Satan himself as a mimic of Yeshua being the Son of God. He will be the son of Satan in the earth, and he will come, and he will be introduced to the world with a delusion, with a lie. And I believe the premise of this lie will be the distortion and the redefinition of creation itself. And there's several things we're going to show you that the Holy Spirit's been showing me concerning that in the weeks to come. But again, what we're doing is we're laying some introduction to the other side of this creation account that is rooted in that other ancient seed, the Sumerian creation account. Now, I've read a 400 and some odd page book of this Christian guy who his call was to go through there and really devour this. So what I tried to do is rather than take you through all the details of that, which I think is unnecessary at this point, I think an overview of understanding the ancient astronaut or the Sumerian or the Babylonian or the mythological seed of creation that they're going to try to counter God's creation truth with, an overview of that would be helpful in our understanding. Does that make sense? So what I did here is I pulled some quotes from Doug Elwell, and I just have to say this, I think it's funny that, you know, we've learned El in Hebrew means mighty one, and his name is Big El, which stands for the God Almighty, and it's got little L in it too, so God of Gods. I just think that's funny. But anyway, that's probably just a joke I would get. But according to Doug Elwell, author and lecturer and master's degree in biblical and ancient Near Eastern studies, he has a book called Planet X, The Sign of the Son of Man in the End of the Age. Now, when you say Planet X, a lot of people's heads go wacko and because there's a lot of that going on in the news right now. If I could get my computer to talk nicely to the audio, which it won't do tonight, I'm going to work on that. But Skywatch TV, how many of you guys keep up to date with Skywatch TV? It's a great Christian news source, skywatchtv.com. They do a daily kind of news overview from a prophetic viewpoint. But they did a program a couple of days ago on planet, they call it Planet 9 instead of Planet X now, because Pluto has been degraded from being a planet. It's too small. Give me an awe. Okay, that's Pluto's heart. It is now just a satellite around one of the other planets. It's no longer a planet status. So instead of Planet X, which was the Roman numeral for 10, now we're looking for Planet 9. Now this is mainstream astronomy. This is not a sideline of, oh, let's look for this. There are anomalies right now going on in our solar system on the outer edge that are causing... They're being defined by gravitational pulls by something very large that NASA says they can't see yet. I wonder what that big telescope on Mount Graham in Arizona that the Vatican has erected, what they're looking at with that infrared telescope attachment called Lucifer, because this possible Planet 9, Planet X, is so large, it's like five times bigger than Earth, but number two, it's a dwarf star. So when you look at it, it's black in a black space, and it takes an ultra-red lens and scope to be able to view it. Now, I had not paid any attention to this at all, had not delved into this, was not, a little bit aware of it. And I came home from the prayer retreat that I mentioned last week, and there was a book, and this was it, on my shelf by Doug Elwell. And when I walked in the bedroom, the Holy Spirit said, it's time to read that book. And I'd gotten it in a free giveaway with some other books I'd ordered. And I thought, really? And I got the book down and started reading it. And God just started putting some pieces together, some other things that he'd shown that I'm going to show later. But I want you to just consider this as we seed this thought tonight. Turn in your scriptures to Matthew chapter 24. Now, everybody's pretty familiar that Matthew 24 is the... address here that Yeshua gives his disciples concerning the end times. And it's kind of the behind-the-scene briefing that we were also given by Holy Spirit. Mark 13 and Luke 21 are the other gospel accounts of this. But I want you to notice this verse. I've never really paid this much attention to this. You have all this stuff that he talks about before. This is not the end. This is before. This is not the end. This is before. And I think we're living in that. And I just want to say this while I'm thinking about it. So many people that you watch about Planet X, I mean, you can go on YouTube right now. Tomorrow, Planet X is going to hit and destroy the world. Ah! You know, I mean, they're just date setters everywhere. I'm like, will you stop it, okay? Yes, there may be a large planetary body that is on an elliptical loop in our solar system. Therefore, it's hard to detect. It's a dwarf star. It has its own moon, its own satellites. It's a system. It is not just a planet. And yes, it has been by Earth before. And yes, there are gravitational anomalies going out in our outer solar system because it's so huge. It's causing gravitational wobbles to happen that they're observing. Yes, it's mainstream extreme astronomy. Yes, this is something happened in our world, okay? But I really had not paid any attention to all this. And all this is coming, and there's like, I mean, hours of stuff we could discuss about this. But I'm just trying to introduce this tonight, okay? And this is what I want you to just think about. In Matthew 24, you got all this stuff before, all this stuff is going to happen. And then look at verse 29. It says, and immediately after the distress of those days, which I believe we are in those days, the sun shall be darkened and the moon shall not give its light, and the stars shall fall from the heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. Now, if you have something as big as Nibiru, planet 9, coming into our solar system, it is interesting that this is what would happen. Now, look at verse 30. And then the sign of the Son of Adam shall appear in the heaven. What is the sign of the Son of Adam? Yeshua himself said before he comes back, this is going to appear at a planet near you. And it's going to be so huge, the earth is going to be darkened, the heavens themselves are going to be shaken, and if you read Luke's account, it says men's hearts are going to be fearing and screaming out because of what is coming upon the earth. It says the oceans are going to be roaring with waves. Do you know that's what it would cause, the gravitational, would cause our poles to shift and would cause roaring of our waves? What was Isaiah saying when he wrote, what causes the earth to shake and wobble like a drunkard? Something bigger than the earth. Now, what we have to start doing is so many times we spiritualize what the word says, and if we go to put a natural cause to it, that can't be. But Yeshua said there's going to be a natural sign. And I'm telling you, I don't know if you remember this, but when we were studying, Noah had a sign for when the flood would come. And what was it? Methuselah. Mm-hmm. Enoch and Jared, they named him Methuselah. And his name meant when he dies, the flood will come. So Noah had a sign. As long as he got up and saw Methuselah, he knew he still had some time. But when Methuselah kicked the can, he knew the flood was coming. And I prayed to the Lord and I said, God, if Noah had a sign and I'm living in the days of Noah, I believe I have a sign too. Good. What is it? Yeah. What am I looking for? And so help me. I mean, God hears those prayers. And I prayed that prayer. And I came home from that retreat and God said, get down that book. And I got it down. And I'm telling you, we're so used to hearing sermons and teaching from people that's just information. But when you have someone teach you things that's experience, God is saying, watch this, read this, do that. I mean, sometimes people can't handle that because God's too personal. But I'm telling you, I didn't desire or think I'm going this direction. And there's something that I'm going to show you, and I'll keep saying it. But it's just supernatural how God led me to some things that God here. But I just want you to be thinking tonight. And you can come up and tell me later. God's probably been downloading you, and you're way ahead of me on what God's saying to you about what's coming. But the sign of the Son of God, of Adam, is going to appear in the heaven. And when you read the sixth seal in the book of Revelation, chapter 6, when the kings and the leaders of the earth freak out because Yeshua shows up in the heavens, the sign of the Son of God shows up in the heavens, and they run into underground bunkers, they run into caves, they run into holes, it says there. And there's a guy right now, there's 4 hours worth of teaching I can order from this government investigator who has investigated why the government is spilling literally trillions of dollars on underground bunkers right now. Not in just America, but all over the world. They're digging their holes that John prophesied on the Isle of Patmos that we're going to run into when, just consider it, the sign of the Son of Man appears in the earth. But how many of you know when the sign of the Son of Man appears, we don't have to run into a hole? Because that's our Messiah. Glory to God. I'm just telling you. And I know all this may be like wild thoughts. Just let them float around over there. And in the next few weeks, we'll just take some of them and look at them. But I want you to consider this, and again, I'm not setting a date. If you start looking at some of this, people will just scare the socks off you. If the world is going to end, you know, tomorrow, and this is... But this, it's amazing how the Lord stirred Doug Elwell's heart. He went and enrolled in an astronomy course in college, astrology, and studied it for like a year, and then he's devoured the scriptures. He is a ancient text genius, knows like billions of things I don't know, and he's gone through all these ancient accounts from the Sumerians and their main mythology called the, in what is it? It's in here. Yeah, Enuma Elish, where they tell this other creation account. And I'm telling you, when you put all this together, what this whole body of scripture says about creation, what scientifically is happening in the world today, and then the premise for this figure coming through lies and deception being the Antichrist and the undermining foundation or the underlying foundation that he's going to be presented on. When you stand back and look at this, it is really a big mouth of bubble gum. Can I get an amen? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's fine. Okay, yeah. Okay. All right, so let's look at this. Again, this is all just some quotes from his book to give us a tie-in for this, okay? Are you with me? Has anybody got a question or concern or feedback? Or you okay? You need some water? I am too. All right. First quote here from Doug's book. A brief survey of ancient creation stories, particularly Mesopotamian creation stories, and we've been talking about those for 3 weeks, makes it clear that the belief that Earth had been created from a body of a dragon by a warrior deity was the dominant creation theme during that period. Now you have to remember, these guys who wrote the Old Testament were not borrowing from these pagan accounts. The people who wrote the pagan accounts were borrowing from the original. So when you read verses in your Old Testament about Rahab the dragon, about Leviathan, they may not just be interesting little verses, especially when they are in direct context of creation. Now, these are just things to think about. And if you're really hungry, you get your concordance out and do your own little study, okay? All right. This was especially true of the ancient Babylonians, whose creation myth, and this is their main one, called the Enuma Elish. Say that with me. The Enuma Elish describes the creation as the result of a battle between the supreme god of their pantheon, which are many gods, Marduk, and an evil dragon goddess named Tiamat. In the Enuma Elish, more generally known as the Babylonian creation epic, Marduk defeats Tiamat and creates heaven and earth. The Babylonians saw the creation as a sort of divine conflict. Say divine conflict.
Divine conflict.
Now, we have to add to this the understanding that before Adam was created and what we know as the earth that we currently live in, that there was a Satan and a kingdom that he ruled over. There was a rebellion of Satan and the world that he ruled over. And then there was a judgment of Satan and the world that he ruled over. We've touched on that a little bit. We may refresh it in the weeks to come. But between Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then verse 2, and the earth was void, and it was empty. The words in the Hebrew, when you go to Isaiah, he uses the same words, and we'll look at these, in the Hebrew that Moses used in Genesis 1:2, that says God creates nothing void and empty.
Right.
Very same, tohu bohu, very same words. So, did God create the earth? Yes. But what does that mean? He didn't create it void and empty. What does that mean? It became void and empty. Mm-hmm. That's why he told Adam not to replenish the earth, but replenish the earth. Something else had been here before we got here. Okay? And this is really going to be important to understand that creation revolves, and Doug Elwell uses this terminology, divine conflict. I don't like to use it, because it sounds like the devil and God are in war. And as you guys know around here, that's just can't happen because it's like a gnat attacking an elephant. There is no war between God and the devil, okay? But there was a divine judgment that the earth came out from when it was created. That's why the Bible says, heaven is my throne, the earth is my... What does the king use a footstool for? Besides propping his feet, he uses it as a place of judgment. He brings his enemy, puts his head there, that's his judgment. He bows to him. We were born in the footstool of God. And he's about to bring revelation and new understanding to us about times past. That's a part of our everlasting covenant because we are eternal beings.
Mm-hmm.
And we may start remembering something we've forgotten, but that may be too much for us all to consider. But there's some things that's going to be restored to us, and there's some information here. And so we're not looking at these pagan creation accounts to try to come up with what the truth is. We need to realize they copied the original, okay? And so when you look at what they copied and what their thinking was in the Middle Eastern thought, when you go back to scripture and you look at the whole thing, it really broadens out and brings some new perspective, okay? Give me a Selah.
Selah.
All right. Third dot, or second dot. The Enuma Elish was the liturgy for a religious ceremony that the Babylonians performed during the height of their Akitu festival, an annual religious festival that was held at the beginning of their new year, on page 21 in the book. So every year, these Babylonians would get together, and guess what they would act out at their big festival? Their creation account, okay? And this is what, you have the Sumerians, and then the Babylon, the head of gold came after that. Then you had the Greeks, and they built their mythologies off of the Babylonians. They built off the Sumerians, and then you have the Romans, and the Romans built their mythology off the Greeks. They built off the Babylonians. They built off the Sumerians. And then you just have one nation after nation, and they have the same mythologies, the same flood story, the same Adam story, the same similarities, but they changed the name of the deities to suit themselves. Then that's really convenient when you have a pantheon with a lot of different gods in it, okay? But there was one original chicken sandwich, amen? All right, let's all go to Chick-fil-A. All right. Third dot. Scholars generally agree that Enuma Elish is not an entirely original Babylonian composition. Instead, they argue that it was actually an adaptation and consolidation of one or more older creation stories borrowed from the Sumerians and the Semitic neighbors. Now, if you were paying attention a couple weeks ago, I helped define who were the Semitic neighbors. Semitic neighbors should read Shemitic neighbors because they come from Shem. Okay? So the Hebrew accounts of creation, they borrowed from. The Akkadians were another group. The two major people groups who had dominated Mesopotamia prior to the Babylonian conquest. Next page. They believed that the Babylonians had conquered the Sumerians and Akkadians, and instead of maintaining their own creation myths, simply borrowed the creation myths of their conquered foes and rewrote them so that the chief god of Babylon, who is Marduk, was glorified as creator of the heavens and earth instead of the Sumerian Akkadian deity named Enlil. Okay? Now that's just some background for you to digest. This borrowing with deity name changes continues on up through the Greeks and the Romans. And that's what we were just talking about. They just changed the names. But they have the same accounts. They all have the same situations. Next dot. In Enuma Elish, the Tower of Babel, which is actually in that account, is seen more as a temple where the Sumerians could worship their gods, Marduk in particular. From this tall tower, they could more easily observe the word and worship their gods, whom they believed were immanent in sun, moon, and stars, and particularly in the planets. Now, it's interesting, when Israel was drawn away from worshiping Jehovah, they would worship the stars and the moon and the planets and the Canaanite gods that they represented, all right? These are ancient deities. And guess what? False deities. They are still alive because they haven't died.
Right.
And we need to understand that what's about to come on the planet, I mean, come on, they're erecting Baal arches in a few days in the planet that you live in. This is not a new god. This is not a new thing. Just praise God we're divorced from Baal. Can I hear a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
In their creation epic, Enuma Elish, the Babylonians actually credited the creation of the city of Babylon and its stage tower, the Tower of Babel, to a group of deities known as the Anunnaki. And we talked about that last week. You're going to hear about the Anunnaki, and you're going to hear them in this modern culture, who, along with a similar group known as the Igigi, were believed to be visible from Earth as the brightest that should be stars in the sky. That's from page 92. So here you have this counterfeit, borrowed creation account that are from star gods who come down from the heavenlies called the Anunnaki, that we actually found a word representing that that interpreted the dream for Nimrod when we were reading the account of Jasser and Abraham. So this interesting tie in there. All right, and then there's another group called the Igigi that works with them. Next point. So according to the Babylonian creation epic, this mysterious Tower of Babel was built either by or with the help of these mysterious Anunnaki. Now, when you go back and you look at the ancient culture, you don't see a learning curve of a lot of things that they had to develop and learn. All of a sudden they didn't have, and then all of a sudden they had planetary understanding. They had orbit understanding. They had implements. They had metalworking. They had all this stuff. We understand it as the watchers. The watchers came down biblically, Genesis 6, and they gave technology to men in exchange for daughters of men to marry, in exchange for other things. They would exchange technologies. They would exchange things that they knew about that they stole from heaven, and they would come down and they would give those forbidden technologies and abilities to men. And if you read the book of Enoch, you find out what they were. We call them watchers. They call them Anunnaki. But the difference between the Anunnaki and the Watchers is the Anunnaki, to them, were benevolent, even though they created them to be slaves and digging their gold mines. But to them, the Anunnaki were star gods who came down, gave them this technology, this ability, and they were for them. They created them. They gave them this technology. Biblically, the truth is the Watchers. Are they for us or against us? They're enemies of God. And they came down and gave technology not to help, but to intermingle with the seed of men to promote their own rebellion against God's ways. And I would just put forth before you tonight that in the last days, that the same thing is going to happen again. What they're going to present themselves as benevolent, is for us, is we're going to give you technology, we're going to save your planet, we're going to help you from killing each other, from blowing each other up. But if you know your scriptural roots, you're going to know these are the same ancient demonic spirits that are coming back, not just to trick a few, but to trick humanity this time with the man of perdition. Now, that's a big picture and a lot to meditate on, but it's interesting. So they see these Anunnaki as coming down to help them build the Tower of Babel. The Sumerian term Anunnaki translate as, quote, those who came down from heaven to earth, end quote, are the same beings described in the Bible as the Watchers. Next point. And I just put in here from tablet 7 of the Enuma Elish, they actually give Marduk 49 names, because God has a lot of titles, so, you know, Satan wants a lot of titles. So he has 49 names that they give him in this creation account. And Nibiru is one of the names given to him. Now, it's just interesting, and I'm just pondering this, okay? But if the ninth planet is the return, and there's some substantiation that I'll present you in the future, that when Yeshua was born, this was also the sign that appeared that the wise men came. So If this is, according to Matthew chapter 24, verse 30, the sign of the Son of Adam, wouldn't Satan want to take that sign and counterfeit it and steal him for himself? Right. And this is what happens in the Enuma Elish. This sign in the heavens, this great star that comes, is not attributed to the sign of Yeshua, but it's the sign of Marduk, the false god. Does that make sense? Okay, mm-hmm. So that's just one of the names. They call him Nibiru, which is the name that Zechariah Sitchin, who was a archaeologist, he just spent his whole life on reading these ancient Babylonian tablets and transcribing them. And you guys, I mean, this is not outer edge stuff. I mean, he met with the head of the United States Navy, with the man that was over the astronomy department for the United States Navy. Him and Zechariah Sitchin met, I think like in the 70s or the 80s, had a meeting. They were both studying Planet 9, and they came away from the meeting saying Nibiru, which is what they call it in the Babylonian culture, and what the Navy astronomer was studying as Planet 9 was the same planet. So I'm just telling you, there's mainstream flow to this, even though you probably didn't get up this morning and think about Planet 9. There are people that are in the earth, okay? Let's read this little thing that they read about Marduk here. Nibiru is the star which in the skies is brilliant. Verily he holds the central position. They shall bow down to him, saying, he who is in the midst of the sea restlessly crosses. Let crossing be his name, who controls its midst. May they uphold the course of the stars of heaven. May he shepherd all the gods like sheep. May he vanquish Tiamat, which is the dragon. May her life be straight and short into the future of mankind when days have grown old. May she recede without cease and stay away forever. Now that's taken again from the Enuma Elish from tablet 7. The verses are given there. Marduk here is clearly stated to be a bright star in the sky, a planet that crosses across the orbits of the other planets. That's why he says he shepherds the other sheep. He is the one that draws them in to that, all right? Now, in this epic, Marduk is portrayed as a supreme deity and represented by a planet or a star called Nibiru that he controls. Now, again, I believe Satan is stealing and counterfeiting this. Right. Letter C. As we review the original scripture creation account, which we're going to get into more possibly next week, we'll see. Passover's got me busy. But as we review the original scriptural creation account, we need to keep these facts in mind and thoughts to ponder. Number one, Satan is the great counterfeiter. He steals what God has done and claims it for himself. Okay? He couldn't create a planet and put it in space if his last day depended on it. All right? Number two, there is no war. Say no war.
No war.
Between good and evil or God and the devil.
That's right.
There is a rebellion of Satan and his fallen ones against God. We've heard that preached a lot here. If you're listening on YouTube, that may be a new thought, but all these movies that we watch that say there is a war between good and evil, in the human sense, that may be true, but not between God and Satan, because God is too big. God does not come down and defeat the dragon in Revelation. Who comes down? Michael is sent to deal with Satan, all right? That's more of a better possibility standoff there. All right, next point. There is scriptural evidence that the earth was created after the judgment of the rebellion of Satan and the worlds he ruled over before Adam. In other words, in contrast to the other creation accounts, there is no divine conflict, but there is a rebellion and a divine judgment in process or progress. Next point. In modern mainstream astrology, if I say mainstream, there is currently, right now, the study and pursuit of identifying planet X or planet 9. Is there any understanding scripturally that might help us concerning understanding this? I believe there is, and I believe that I will be presenting that as the Holy Spirit leads. Next, all of the creation account in Scripture is not just in Genesis 1, but as Chuck Missler says, and I love this, a quote from Chuck, The Bible is an integrated message system sent from someone outside of our timeline, written with the expectation of hostile jamming. What does that mean? You can't just tear out Genesis 1 and tear out all the understanding of creation. God interwove it in His Word through the men that He inspired to write these books. Just like you can't tear out the chapter on the Holy Spirit, or you can't tear out the chapter on Yeshua. It's an integrated message system. But we need to read it that way, and we need to understand it that way. Therefore, you can't just rip out Genesis 1, as I said. You need to see the big picture. Letter D. With this basic understanding of the ancient Eastern creation mythos, it is important to approach creation from the heart position from which anyone should approach understanding how God created the universe. And we're going to end with this tonight. Turn to Job chapter 38. You know, Job really has a lot to say about creation and God's lesson that He gave him there. Job's hiding. I've got that Hebraic order of books, and sometimes I still get confused where they are. Come here, Job.
After Proverbs.
Ah, thank you. All right, Job 38. Let's start reading in verse 1. Then Jehovah answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, now think about this in light of creation, because that's what he's talking to him about. Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Now gird up your loins like a man, and I ask you, and you answer me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Who can answer that tonight? Declare if you have understanding. And to me, when I was going to preface our study on the scripture accounts of creation, you have to start with this heart position. Because you guys, even as much as the Holy Spirit is going to help us as we review creation from these sources in the scripture and look at them, where were we? You know, and we are totally reliant upon the Holy Spirit to reveal what we need. Amen.
Sorry.
Verse 5, who set its measurements, if you know? Or who stretched the line upon it? Upon what were its foundations sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of Elohim shouted for joy. Now remember that Satan is called son of the morning star. And remember that he was one of the sons of God, but he actually is still, but he's a rebellious one, that's mentioned here, who actually saw the creation of the earth that you and I live in. So they have knowledge and insight that we don't have, because where were we? We might have been there because we are eternal, but do we have memory of it? Not unless the Holy Spirit gives it to us. Okay? But they were there, and they sang. The morning stars and the sons of Elohim are the same word in Genesis 6, the B'nai Elohim. They were the angelic orders that watched God judge Satan and create the world. And you're going to see that come to play here in just a moment. Verse 8, or who enclosed the sea with doors when it burst forth and came from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and assigned for it my law and set bars and doors and said, this far you have come, but no farther, and here your proud waves stop. How many of you have ever gone to Florida or the coast and pondered that verse? I've stood at the shore many times and thought, as the waves would come in and just touch my feet and roll back out, that they stop because of the law of God. God said, this far you come and no further. You know, that's just, I just love to sit there and ponder and hear that. But look at this, verse 12. Now think about this being in the setting of creation and the divine judgment or conflict of God here going on. Verse 12. Have you ever commanded the morning and caused the dawn to know its place. Now remember in Isaiah 14 that Satan is called son of the dawn. So we're coming into a little different introduction here. Verse 13, and to hold and take hold of the ends of the earth and the wrong be shaken out of it. Now wait a minute. Why is God creating the world, the earth, as we know it, but he's shaking the wrong out of it? But this is the creation account? Something's going on here. All right, look at verse 14. It changed like clay under a seal. What it was, it isn't anymore. And they stand out like a garment. Could that be talking about the ones who rebelled against God? Verse 15, and their light is withheld from the wrong. And notice this, and the arm lifted up is what? Broken. Why would you lift an arm up against God and he would break it if there was not hint here of a rebellion that was taking place? Right. Again, this is in the context of creation. Keep reading. Verse 16, have you come to the sources of the sea, or have you walked about in the recesses of the deep? Were the gates of death revealed to you, or have you seen the gates of the shadow of death? Have you understood the breadth of the earth? Declare if you know it all. Anybody want to take us up on that tonight? This was thousands of years ago. One of the first lessons in the Bible, the book of Job. What to do when you feel like you have unjust suffering in your life.
Come on.
The first lesson is to realize, where were you? Can you trust God whom you are in covenant with? You may not understand why what's happening in your life is happening right now, but the lesson of Job is God is an authority. He is a good God, and he will work all things out according to his will and good pleasure. Even if at the moment in our little finite brain, we don't understand it.
That's right.
Verse 19, where is the way to the dwelling of light? Ooh. And darkness, where is its place? That you should take it to its boundary and know the path to its home. Do you know? For you would have been born then, and the number of your days had been many. Verse 22, have you entered into the storehouses of snow? Or have you seen the storehouses of hail? Now notice this, verse 23, which I have kept for the time of distress, for the day of fighting and battle. What is this? We're right here in a creation account. Why is he called the Lord of the hosts of the armies of heaven? Why are there guards around the throne of God called cherubim that have eyes all over them? Why are there gates to heaven? Why are there walls? I mean, these are some questions to ponder. Where are we? What do we really know? We need the Holy Spirit to reveal and give us some fresh revelation of some things. And I want to jump over. I'm not going to get into Pleiades and Orion and the stuff that's mentioned that Job would have had no way of knowing here that were recorded, that God writes later in these verses, that they're bound together. The only constellations that are bound together in our solar system are mentioned in the book of Job. Oh, I mean, God is amazing. But look over here. I just got to look at this, and we're going to look at one other verse. Verse 38, it says, when the dust hardens in clumps and the clods cling together, you know, it was talking about the storehouses of snow here, I believe. Who has wisdom to count the clouds or to tip over the bottles of the heaven when the dust hardens in clumps and the clocks cling together? I'm going through third grade science right now in my house. And one of the things we just learned is how snow forms. That it forms from dust particles in the clouds that begin to accumulate water molecules. And they keep coming, and that's why they form those awesome shapes that fall down. They form from dust. And it's amazing here that Job, through God revealing his understanding of creation, Job wasn't able to get a microscope and go up there and look at the dust clods that form in the clouds that make snow. I mean, come on, God is amazing, amen? Okay,
yeah.
One other conflict thing I want you to see here. I just want you to start understanding that in the midst of creation scriptures, not in the Genesis 1 account, although alluded to Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2, when you read the other accounts, there are mentions here of some kind of conflict. divine judgment going on, and it's spread out. We're going to look at some others, but chapter 40, let's just look at 6 through 14 here in closing. It says, then Jehovah answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, verse 7, now gird up your loins like a man, I ask you, and you answer me. I may try that at home sometime with Mark. Now gird up your loins like a man. No, I think that would go over very well. Verse 8. Would you also set aside my judgment? Would you pronounce me wrong and you be declared righteous? Look at this. Or do you have an arm like El, the mighty one? Or do you thunder with a voice like his? Deck yourself, please, with excellency and grandeur, and put on esteem and splendor. Scatter abroad the rage of your wrath. All this is in context of creation. And look on everyone who is proud and bring him low. Who could do that in this room tonight? Who can so clothe himself with grandeur and splendor and so be mindful that just come in the room that everyone cowers at your presence?
Miss Cheryl.
And that's going to go across the world. I mean, come on. This is our God. He just clothed. You know, think about the scripture when Isaiah said he wrapped himself in zeal and vengeance and came down. I mean, what was going on right there? And he's going to do it again.
Come.
Verse 12, look on everyone who is proud. Just look on him and humble him. I don't have that look down. Do you have that look down? You know? Look on everyone who is proud. I love it when Isaiah said, and Jehovah alone will be exalted on that day. The proud will be brought low. Jehovah alone. And I'm telling you, if I'm still researching and praying, and we'll study this together, if the sign of the Son of Man, we know that's true, but if it is an arm of God's judgment that periodically circles the earth and has a history of events that history has recorded for us that you can parallel, which is interesting, if that is God's sign, when he appears, tell me who will not be humbled?
Come on.
I mean, Revelation 6 says, when the sign of the Son of Man appears in the earth, they're going to run in holes. I mean, bye, Obama. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Hide them in the dust together and bind their faces in obscurity. That's what happens when God comes down.
Yeah.
That's what happens when the sign of the Son of Man shows up and it's coming again. So that was just an overview of the Enuma Elish creation account. We've been building this up for several weeks, so you got some legs under you there. And this is an introduction into look for the rebellion and judgment elements in creation passages in our scriptures. Because there's things that God wants us to know, and in the days ahead, we need to know them. All right?